So sometimes it's hard to sort out fact from fiction. With the celebration of President's Day, I was thinking about George Washington, and we all know that story of how truthful Washington was, that receiving the new hatchet and chopped down the cherry tree, and Dad said, you know, who did this? And I cannot tell a lie, I did. Unfortunately, it's not true. An early biographer of Washington, to illustrate what was true, that Washington was a person of great honor and of great truthfulness, made up the story as an illustration of this. So the story isn't true, but Washington's truthfulness was. It's sometimes hard to sort those things out. Or this time of year, you kind of expect it to be cold. And when I was a kid, I had always told by my mom and dad, make sure you wear a hat. 80% of your body heat will escape through your head if you're not wearing a hat. And I was curious about that, and I went and looked that up. It's a little bit more complicated than that, because in cold weather, we are normally dressed everywhere else except for our head. Then it's true that you would lose 80% of your body heat from your head. However, what I read was if you were naked, you'd be losing it through your entire body. It's just the fact that we're bundled up that that happens to be true. Or I want to talk about another piece of information that you may have heard at different points. That is that when they study the divorce rate in relationships, they've determined that the divorce rate, unfortunately, is the same amongst people of faith, Christians, and people who are not. However, when you dive a little bit deeper into that particular piece of information, there's a little bit of a myth in there. And that's what the definition of a Christian is. Because when they ask the survey in a different way, we find out about this myth. When they ask in the survey, do you regularly worship together or not? That dramatically changes the divorce separation rate for couples. When they ask that question, in fact, they've found the graph that you'll see on the screen, that the more someone regularly worships together, the more it strengthens their relationship, all the way from never worshiping together at 48%, the same as the general population, all the way down to 27% when a couple says that they weekly worship together. Or in another study that they did, the rate actually dropped from like 1 in 2 relationships all the way to 1 in 30 relationships when a couple says that they worship weekly together. I want to dive into that and spend a little bit of time with that this morning, as again, coming off of Valentine's Day. But I also acknowledge, looking out at the congregation, that not everybody is married. There's some young people out there, not even on your radar yet to think about being married. I know there are other folks who would like to be married, just haven't found the right person yet. I see other folks who are married, and I know some folks are divorced or separated, and we'll talk a little bit about that as well. As much as you wanted that to work and stay together, it didn't. And I know for some folks, you're widowed or widowered, and maybe you'd even testify to what did strengthen your relationship, but this might be a little hard for you as well. But I not only want to think about marriage, but all kinds of relationships, whether you're married or not. I think worshiping regularly together strengthens friendships. It strengthens families. It strengthens all of who we are when we regularly worship together. I'm going to particularly explore that through marriage, but I think you could apply it in multiple ways in our relationships. So why is it that this rate changes so much when they ask about regularly worshiping together? I think there's a couple things that we would probably notice. One of those is that important in a relationship is commitment. Commitment is a real solid strength in any relationship, especially in marriage. I used to work with a lady years ago. She was an older lady who had been married a number of years, and almost everybody else in this particular office were young people, many of them preparing for marriage as I was when I knew her, or who were newly married. And so they often went to her as kind of this wise person of many years of marriage, and they would ask, you know, what is the secret? Do you ever think about divorce? And she would say, divorce, never. Murder, sometimes. Which did say something about her sense of humor, but it also said something about her sense of commitment. Because commitment is so important in a relationship. I mentioned earlier folks that are even divorced or separated who maybe even did regularly worship together. But what I've noticed in those relationships, even when they needed to end, that those folks strived and tried incredibly hard to make those relationships work, even when they didn't. And that sense of commitment of being in worship was a huge strength. And that makes sense. When we come to worship, when we celebrate God's commitment to us, we're just coming off the Christmas season and we remember God's gift of Jesus coming and living amongst us, and we're moving into that season when we remember Jesus' sacrifice for us, his great commitment for us. How could not worshiping, coming and celebrating that sense of commitment, how could that not affect and bless and strengthen our relationships in marriage and in all kinds of forms? Certainly our commitment is deepened when we worship together. And another quality that's deepened as well is a sense of forgiveness. Very, very important in any relationship. An older couple came out and highlighted this to me. They said they've been married 61 years and noted how they don't argue. They just let things go and how important that is. I was thinking for myself, my wife and Carolyn and I celebrated 25 years this summer of marriage. And forgiveness, certainly, you know, when I think about it, if we would care to, after 25 years of marriage, we could make some really long lists of frustrations, of things that we've said that we shouldn't, of things that we should have said that we didn't, things that we did or didn't do, which have hurt and offended. I'm sure that we could make really long lists. My wife, I'll agree, longer lists than mine. But we don't do that. Because if we did that, if we kept track of every wrong and every frustration, we worked through it, and then we let it go. Because forgiveness is so important in a relationship. I've certainly seen folks that had struggling relationships where they held on to hurts and pains, and it just damaged their relationship. And to come to worship is to be reminded of the forgiveness that we are given. We celebrated already Holy Communion. We ate the bread and the wine, and we remembered the body and the blood of Jesus and God's great forgiveness to us. And when we're regularly filled with that forgiveness, how could we but go and sit back down in the pew next to a spouse that maybe we had a fight or a frustration with this week? And remembering the forgiveness we've been given, we share the forgiveness that we need with each other. Certainly, worshiping regularly strengthens us in our sense of forgiveness. And one other quality as well that I think really gets deepened when we worship regularly with each other, and that's sacrifice. Whenever I marry a couple, I almost always highlight to them that they give themselves away. It's the only way that marriage works well, when the spouse gives themselves away to the other and the spouse gives themselves away to each other. For when we give of ourselves, that's when we have that close, great relationship that we seek and we want. Makes me think of the description by a wonderful writer and teacher, Leo Biscaglia. Leo Biscaglia wrote a number of books about love. He actually taught a class at the University of Southern California in love. And he would often talk about his parents. He said his parents were first-generation Italian. They had an arranged marriage. His mom used to joke that she didn't get a good look at her husband till about a week after they were married. And he said that they didn't have this great marriage because they found the right person. They were arranged with each other, but because they chose to be the right person, that they gave themselves away to each other. And again, when we gather and we worship, we remember the sacrifice given to us that strengthens our relationships. Up front hangs a cross just to remind us of the sacrifice given to us. And when that sacrifice is firm in our hearts, then that overflows as we give ourselves away to each other. There's a wonderful scripture passage that reminds us of this that I want to read to you. It's found in the Gospel of John, one of the accounts of Jesus' life. And right toward the end, in the 15th chapter, Jesus is instructing and teaching his disciples, for he knows that he is soon going to the cross. And he gives this commandment, often referred to as the new commandment. He says to his disciples and to us, "As the Father has loved me, so I have loved you. Abide in my love." That chain of love that Jesus had from his Father. "If you keep my commandments, you will abide in my love, just as I have kept my Father's commandments and abide in his love. I have said these things to you so that my joy may be in you and that your joy may be complete." And then this new commandment. "This is my commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you." Days after saying this to his disciples, Jesus will go to the cross and demonstrate to them the love that he is talking about, the sacrificial love that gives itself away. And when we take this commandment to heart, it has the power to bless our relationships as we give ourselves away to each other. There's a wonderful scene in a movie that, for me, just captures this sense of how we need God's sacrificial love to have that overflow in our relationships. It's in a wonderful movie created by a church down south. The movie is called Fireproof, and I highly recommend it. It's just a wonderful relationship-building movie. And there's a scene where the one character, played by Kirk Cameron, his marriage is in trouble, and his father reminds him of the love that he truly needs in his marriage.
"Caleb, if I were to ask you why you're so frustrated with Catherine, what would you say?"
"She's stubborn. She makes everything difficult for me. She's ungrateful. She's constantly griping about something."
"Has she thanked you for anything you've done the last 20 days?" "No."
"And you'd think after I wash the car, I change the oil, do the dishes, clean the house, that she would try to show me a little bit of gratitude.
But she doesn't. In fact, when I come home, she makes me feel like I'm an enemy. I'm not even welcome in my own home, Dad. That is what really ticks me off."
"Dad, for the last 3 weeks, I have bent over backwards for her. I have tried to demonstrate that I still care about this relationship. I bought her flowers, which she threw away. I have taken her insults and her sarcasm, but last night was it. I made dinner for her. I did everything I could to demonstrate that I care about her, to show value for her, and she spat in my face. She does not deserve this, Dad. I am not doing it anymore. How am I supposed to show love to somebody over and over and over who constantly rejects me?"
"That's a good question."
Dad, that is not what I'm doing.
Isn't it?
No. Dad, that is not what this is about.
Son, you just asked me. How can someone show love over and over again when they're constantly rejected? Caleb, the answer is, you can't love her because you can't give her what you don't have. I couldn't truly love your mother until I understood what love really was. It's not because I get some reward out of it. I've now made a decision to love your mother whether she deserves it or not. Son, God loves you even though you don't deserve it. Even though you've rejected him, spat in his face. God sent Jesus to die on the cross and take the punishment for your sin because he loves you. The cross was offensive to me until I came to it. But when I did, Jesus Christ changed my life. That's when I truly began to love your mom. Son, I can't settle this for you. This is between you and the Lord. But I love you too much not to tell you the truth. Can't you see that you need him? Can't you see that you need his forgiveness?